Alright, inshallah, open up, inshallah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا وشر من لا يرضى وشر من محرم عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم أما بعد We begin by saying أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم We seek refuge in Allah from Shaitan and curse, for verily He is a doomable being and about enemy to mankind. And we always begin by saying, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most merciful, the most merciful. Truly and verily, all praise is due to Allah, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. We praise Him and seek only His help and His forgiveness. And we also seek refuge in Allah from evil of our nafs, which is our carnal desires, for verily the nafs is inclined to rusu. We also seek refuge in Allah from the sayyat and marinat, those deeds and those actions that are not sanctioned by Allah in the Quran, and those deeds and actions that are not sanctioned by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Sunnah. Those whom Allah will to be guided to Islam, nobody can lead them astray. And those whom Allah will to be misguided off the Siratul Mustaqim, and nobody can guide. We bear witness that there is no God but Allah, the one God who has no partners. And we bear witness that Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his slave and his messenger. Amma ba'd. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that verily the best speech, the best hadith is the speech of Allah in the Quran, and the best guidance is the guidance of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Sunnah. And the worst of all matters are those things that are innovated by the people. But all innovation leads to bid'ah. All bid'ah leads to dalala, which is off the Surat al-Mustaqim. And all dalala is an nar, which is the fire. So we seek refuge from Allah from that nar, from that fire. O Allah, give us good in this life, hasana. Give us good in the next life, hasana. Waqina adhab an-nar, and O Allah, save us from the punishment of the fire, Ya Allah. Ameen. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Allah blesses with another day of life. So Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, He gives another opportunity to do better than we did yesterday. Inshallah, to make some corrections, some reflection. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Allah blesses with another day of ta'aleem, to gain some knowledge of His deen, so we can implement it, inshallah. Today's subject matter is with regards to purifying the heart, right? Or safeguarding the heart, purifying the heart. Okay? In Islam is the middle path. Okay? We believe in all the scriptures of old, we believe in all the prophets of old. Back in the day, with regards to Musa alayhi salam, with regards to Musa alayhi salam, with regards to Moses, if you go through the Old Testament, there's a lot of rules, a lot of regulations. Right? It was all about the law, the law, the law. Right? People were being stoned to death. People were being flogged. Okay? There was many laws, many punishment for the laws. Okay? So in the time of Musa, it was very rigorous. Right? Very rigorous with regards to the laws, with regards to holding fast to the laws, holding fast to the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Isa came, it was more of a spiritual realm. More about dealing with oneself. Going into oneself. Right? Isa, a lot of parables. Right, there wasn't a lot of rules and regulations. There wasn't a lot of punishments or hudus with regards to Isa alayhi salam. So with regards to Musa alayhi salam, it was a physical aspect. With regards to Isa alayhi salam, which was Jesus, it was more of a spiritual. Okay? But with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, with regards to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, right, he came with the final revelation. Right, he came with the completeness of his deen. Right, Allah will say, this day I have completed for you, right, my favor upon you, right, and perfected for you Islam and chosen for you Islam as your deen. So with the laws of Islam, we have a balance. It's not too rigorous, not too much with the laws of the physical, and not too rigorous with the laws of the spiritual. We don't go overboard with either or, the physical or the spiritual. Inshallah, we have a balance. There is some physical and there is some spiritual. And with regard to this, it requires, you know what I'm saying, a looking into the heart, or a taskiyah to nafs, right? We say a taskiyah to nafs, which means the purifying of the nafs, or the purifying of the soul, or the purifying of the heart. We have a hadith. There is a hadith that people like to quote, and it's thrown out there all the time, but yet it's a da'if hadith. Some people say it's a ma'udu hadith. It's a fabricated hadith. When the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is supposedly has said that when he came from the battlefield, he said, we came from the minor jihad to come to the major jihad. which is the jihad of the nafs. Okay? This is a da'if hadith. This is a maudhu hadith. This is a fabricated hadith. Okay? There is nothing greater than the physical jihad. And the Prophet Muhammad said in multiple hadiths, with the regards to sahih hadiths, when they asked him, Ya Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is there anything bigger or any reward bigger than one who dies on the battlefield? He said, nothing. There's nothing better than that. Nothing greater than that. Okay? So there's multiple hadiths with regards to the physical aspect of exerting yourself to the utmost of your deen. Right? This is the greatest reward. This is the fawzul adeem. There's nothing greater than that. But yet, there is hadith with regards to the purifying of the soul, the purifying of the heart. But with regards to the hadith, with regards to saying, I came from the minor jihad, now the bigger jihad, this is a maudhu hadith, this is a fabricated hadith. But we do believe in purifying one's heart. We do believe in purifying the soul. Okay? But that hadith is a fabricated hadith. Okay? We have a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, again, because today's subject matter is regards to the heart. Okay? Purifying the heart. Focusing on the heart. Okay? We have a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying, he said, you do not have any iman. You do not have any iman unless you rectify your heart. Right? And you don't have any iman unless you rectify your tongue. Right? Guard your tongue. So we put emphasis on your heart, and we put emphasis on the tongue. Okay? Again, we have a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he said there's a part of the body, a piece of flesh in the body, that if it's good, then the whole body is good. If it's bad, then the whole body is bad. And this is the heart. Okay? You don't have any iman unless you rectify your heart, rectify your qawm, right? And rectify your tongue. Okay? The Prophet Muhammad said that many people will be toppled over one another in the hellfire because of their tongue. Okay? And the Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, we understand with regards to the other part of the hadith, with regards to those who don't say God was between their legs, but they'll be thrown into the hellfire because what's between their tongue, I mean, what's between their mouth, right? Their two lips, meaning their tongue, or their two jaws. He said, yes. Many people will say things, they take it lightly, but in the sight of Allah, it's big. So there'll be many people toppled over one another, right, in the hellfire because of the tongue. Rasulullah said, if you don't have nothing good to say, don't say nothing at all. Okay? All of this goes to, with regards to the heart. Because the heart, it is the manifestor, right, of the whole body. If it's good, the whole body is good. If your heart is good, then you're going to watch what you say out of your mouth. Right? He said, you don't have any mind unless you rectify your heart. Okay? So again, we're talking about the heart today. Okay? We're talking about the heart. This is part of the deen. Right? We're not going overboard with it, but yet we still have to talk about, right, rectifying, purifying the tazkiyah of the nafs. Right? The purifying of the heart. The purifying of the soul. Okay? Again, we have another hadith for the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said that Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, He does not look at a person's character. He does not look at their body structure. He does not look at their skin. He doesn't care about your money. He don't care about none of that. He don't care about your form. Right? But He cares about the heart. The thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look at on the Day of Judgment is the heart. What was your heart like? Right? What is your heart like? So He doesn't look at your body. He doesn't look at your structure. He doesn't look at what color you are. He doesn't look at what color your eyes are, what kind of hair you have, how strong you are, right? How tall you are, how much money you got. He doesn't care about none of that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look at the heart and see what's in the heart. Okay? We have another hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Sahabas, they were on the battlefield. Okay? They were fighting jihad. Again, this is talking about the heart. We're just giving you certain hadiths, certain quotes from the Quran with regards to the heart. Right? So inshallah we'll have a better understanding of what it is that we're talking about. In the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were on the battlefield. They were fighting jihad. Right? And one of the Sahabas, he came to the enemy and he was getting ready to kill, you know, this person. Right? But before he killed this person, this infidel or this kafir or this non-Muslim, he took the shahada and said, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. I bear witness that there is no God but Allah. And that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. But this sahab, this companion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he killed that person anyway. Because remember, when a person takes the shahada, his blood, his property, is sacred. Okay? You take the shahada, your blood, your property is sacred. So this person took shahada, right? He wanted to save himself. Right? But yet this sahaba, he still killed him anyway. So the news went back to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he kept asking him, did you open up his heart and look into his heart to see if he had iman? Did you open up his heart? Could you see into his heart and see if he had iman? Right? And that sahaba said, man, I wish that I wasn't even born, you know, that day. He kept saying it and saying it to the point that he said, I wish I was never born. Right? Because he felt so bad. Okay? Proving again that we don't know what's in the heart. Right? So a person can say something. Yes, he could have said something to save himself. Right? He could have said something in order to save his life, right? And there's some people that say certain things because they want certain benefits in his deen. We don't know. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's in the heart, right? So the focus is on the heart, right? Allah don't look at the outer appearance. Allah don't care what we say out of our mouth. Allah looks into the heart, okay? We have another ayah in the Quran. In chapter 49, verse 13. Chapter 49, verse 13, the Surah Al-Hujurat. Okay, and in this surah, there's much benefit, there's much wisdom in here. We talked about these things, but again, this is a dhikr, a reminder. In Surah Al-Hujurat, Allah said that He created many tribes and different nations. We created you with many different tribes and many different nations. It's in order that you may get to know one another. Right? He made us black, white, right, brown, yellow. Right, African, Asian, Mongolian, whatever it may be. He makes it to different tribes and different nations. This is from one of the signs of Allah. He said that one of the signs of Allah is that He made us in different colors. Right? This is a miracle from Allah. All of us come from Adam alayhi salam, Adam and Eve alayhi salam. Okay? Going into biology, Adam alayhi salam, black, the black clay. All colors come from black. He said this is one of His miracles. Right? So we made you in different tribes and different nations, in order that you may get to know one another. But the best in the sight of Allah is he or she who has the most taqwa, right? The most God consciousness, the one who fears Allah the most, right? And so the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith, "Attaqwahuna, attaqwahuna," and he pointed to his heart. He said, "Taqwa is here. I created you with different tribes and different nations, right? So that you get to know one another, right? Different foods, different type of clothing, right? Different type of customs and whatnot, traditions. There's nothing wrong with being different. There's nothing wrong with wearing different types of clothes, right? Having different type of foods, right? This is from the miracles of Allah. We don't all have to be eating the same thing. We don't all have to be dressing the same thing, right? Some of us don't like bologna, right? Some people eat bologna, they like bologna. Some people eat steak, some people eat fish, some people eat rice. Some people eat barbecue chicken, right? There's a difference, right? Allah made this. This is a miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So He said, "Ataqwa huna." Taqwa is here. We made you a different tribe, different nations, black, white, brown, right? But that which makes you best in the sight of Allah is the one who has the most taqwa, right? In another hadith, the Prophet Muhammad said, "Ataqwa huna, ataqwa huna." Taqwa is here in the heart. It's in the heart, right? Again, everything focusing on the heart. What your heart like, right? Not what your mind like, what your lip service like, but what your heart like. And if your heart is manifested with taqwa, if your heart is manifested with iman, right? It'll be shown through your actions. It'll be shown through your actions. Okay. We also have other ayats in the Quran. Multiple ayats in the Quran. Where Allah says in the Quran, He said, it is not their eyes that are blind. It is not their eyes that are a'ma, right? Blind. He said, but it is their hearts that are blind. Okay? You can have 20/20 vision. You can see very clearly. You don't need no glasses. You can see all the way across the room or all the way across whatever it may be. Right? I can see clearly. I have 20/20 vision, 20/10 vision, whatever it may be. But Allah will say it is not their eyes that are blind, but it is their hearts that are blind. Right? They're blind to the dhikr. They're blind to the reminder. They're blinded to the haq. Right? Because it said this is where iman resides. Again, coinciding with all of these hadith. This is where taqwa resides. Right? This is where your faith resides in the heart. So therefore, you have to work on your heart. It's not just the actions, again, the physical. Yes, the physical is part of it. You won't even be able to do the physical, right, unless your spiritual is intact. Right? Although we say that the hadith is a da'if hadith. We just came from the, you know, the minor jihad to go to the major jihad, which is the nafs. But actually, it's backwards. Because in order to do the physical, you have to have the spiritual. So you have to have your heart intact first. Because if you don't have taqwa, you don't have iman, you won't be able to do the physical. You won't be able to go into the battlefield. You won't be willing to put your life on the line because your heart is not intact. When anybody goes into a fight, for instance, a boxer, a wrestler, whatever it may be, somebody's going into a battle, and then we understand that the person that we're at war with, the person that we're battling is Shaitan, right? He's a dumb being. He's an avowed enemy to mankind. You're going to war with Shaitan, right? You go into the ring, right? A person gets whooped, boom, 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 boom. Why? At the end of the battle, he says what? Man, his heart wasn't in it. His heart wasn't in it. He didn't have faith, right? He didn't train. He didn't have understanding. Your heart got to be in it. You're going against Shaitan, your heart got to be in it. You want to go into the battlefield, your heart got to be in it. You got to purify your heart. You got to work on that heart. You got to work on your taqwa. You got to work on your iman, right? You got to work on your faith, okay? And again, Allah says in the Quran, it is not their eyes that are blind, right? You can see, you can hear, right? But it's their hearts that are blind, right? So we need to work on our heart, right? Allah says in the Quran, that those who have iman, right? Those who have iman, those who have faith. And remember the Prophet Muhammad said, there is no iman. Right? And iman is belief. There is no iman without amal. Right? There is no iman without amal. Amal means actions. Many people say that they believe. Right? There is no iman without amal. Right? There is no faith. There is no belief without actions. Many people say that they believe. I believe. I believe. Right? Your mouth says that. Your tongue says that. Right? But what about your actions? Faith or iman is manifested by one's actions. Right? There is no iman without amal. Just like in the book of old. We go into the scriptures of old, the New Testament, right? The book of James. In the book of James, I think it's 2 James. There's James 1 and James 2 in the Bible. In the book of James, it says faith without actions is dead. Faith without actions is dead. Therefore, just to say that we believe in something, right? This Christian concept, again, we're talking about the spirituality, right? And Musa alayhi salam was the physical aspect. But Isa alayhi salam was a physical aspect. They're still stuck on that physical aspect. Remember the time of Jesus. Okay, we go into the scripture. And Isa alayhi salam, he said, those who do not have a sword, go buy one. This is in the scripture. He said, and those who don't have a sword, let him go buy one. Right? And in another scripture in the New Testament, Isa alayhi salam, he said, do not think that I came to bring peace. Right? But I came to bring destruction. I came to bring chaos and confusion between the husband, the wife, the children. He said, don't think that I came to bring peace. I didn't come to bring peace. Right? But he said, I came to bring, you know what I'm saying, confusion between the household. Right? But again, in the time of Isa alayhi salam, he said, let those who do not have a sword, let them go buy one. Why did he say go buy one? Right? He told them to get ready. Right? When Isa alayhi salam, before he left, he said, I have many things to tell you, but you cannot bear them now. For I must go, and he will come, and he'll teach you new things. But get ready. But right now is not the time. In the time of Isa alayhi salam, when they came to Isa alayhi salam, and the soldiers came, the Roman soldiers came, and they tried to get Isa alayhi salam, what happened? One of his companions, they cut off one of the soldiers' ear. So they had swords. It wasn't all about the spiritual. Some of them have swords. He said, let him who does not have a sword, let him go buy one. Right? And when they came to get Isa alayhi salam, the Roman soldiers came, what happened? One of his disciples took the sword, ha, and cut off one of the ears of the soldiers. One of the miracles, Isa alayhi salam, he took the ear and put it back on. Okay? So they had swords. So there was a physical aspect, but he said it's not that time right now. It's not time for that right now. Okay? So again, in Musa alayhi salam, it was a physical. Isa alayhi salam, it was a spiritual. But he was saying, get ready though. Right? And somebody's going to come after me. He's going to remind you of the things of me. He's going to teach you new things. This was the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the middle path. Yes, we have a spiritual aspect, but there's a physical aspect as well. The middle path. Physical, right? And the spiritual, inshallah. Okay? Also, we have in the Quran, Allah will say that those who, when they hear the Quran, their hearts become humble. Their hearts tremble, right? With fear, right? In order to have a measuring stick, or a rule of thumb, or a measuring stick, and try to find out what your heart's made of. When you hear the Quran, when you hear the dhikr, when you hear the reminder, what happens to your heart? Right? One who has taqwa of Allah, one who has iman of Allah, when they hear the dhikr of Allah, it said their hearts become humble. Right? You hear Allah's dhikr, you hear Allah's reminder. Allah will say this. Right? Allah will say that. And it's something that reminds you of something that you may be doing or not doing, or something that you may have the potentiality of doing. What happens? You become humble. You're like, man, I want to be done with Shaitan Rajim. Right? This is how you check what you're working with. This is how you check your temperature. Right? This is how you check your heart. When you hear the dhikr of Allah, what happens? Okay? So again, Allah said it's not their eyes that are blind, but it's their hearts that are blind. We're told again with regards to the heart. In Surah Al-Baqarah, in the first chapter, excuse me, chapter 2 of the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, after the Fatiha, Allah is telling us about the heart. Allah says, in the heart is a disease. Right? كَتَبَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ سَمْعِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. Allah says, the first thing He says is, with regards to those who disbelieve, He says, كَتَبَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ. The first thing that He talks about is the heart. The reason why they disbelieve is because they have a khatam, they have a seal, right, around their heart. They can't hear anything. It doesn't matter whether you warn them or warn them not, right, they won't believe. Why? خَتَبَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ سَمْعِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ أَبْصَارِهِمْ غِشَاوَةٌ. Upon their hearts is a khatam, right? Upon their ears is a khatam, and on their eyes is a gishawa, there's a covering, right? So again, Allah is talking about the heart. Your heart controls the whole body. Your heart controls the whole body, okay? So we must learn how to work on the heart. And another hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Again, this is just a dhikr, Quran hadith with regards to the heart. So yes, we do have to work on the heart. We have to worry about the heart. We got to purify the heart, right? Allah talks about what is called rana. Rana. Right? We have khatam. We have khatam. Khatam is the seal. Right? This is a seal on the heart. Khatam also means, khatam means like a ring or a seal. Right? Or it's closed off. Right? Like Allah SWT said in the Quran, with regard to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, khatam al-Nabiyyin, he's the seal of the prophets, it's closed off, it's sealed, there are no more prophets, there are no more messengers after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, khatam is over with. Right? Allah SWT talks about the disbelievers, that there's a khatam on their heart, a seal on their heart, so therefore that's why they can't believe. Right? But before they get this khatam, Allah tells us through the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with regards to the rana, right? What is the rana? He said that when a Muslim or a person sins, every time a person sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts a black dot. A black dot. On the heart.
So the rana is the black dot or the black dots
that are on the heart. Okay? All of this is knowledge. Right? All of this is dhikr. All of this is ilm. Right? You strive to gain knowledge, right, to make your path to paradise easy. You gotta have knowledge of the heart. What's going on? What's the reality of the matter?
So the Prophet Muhammad said that every time a person sins, Allah puts a black dot on the heart. Right? This black dot, this is called arana. Right? This is it. This is not khatam yet. This is not a seal.
But Allah will put black dots on the heart. The more black dots you have, as we'll see, it covers the heart. Right? The heart has to be open to the nur. It has to be open to the haq. It has to be open to iman and taqwa. Right? It has to be open to the dhikr.
So the Prophet Muhammad said that every time a person sins, Allah puts a black dot on the heart. Right? And every time that person does a good deed, right, he erases or polishes that black dot where the heart becomes purified again. It becomes whole again. It becomes clean again. That's why Allah said in the Quran, and if you do a wrong deed, follow it up with a good deed that will expiate. Right? You do something wrong. You know you did something wrong. Right? Whatever it may be. Whether saying something wrong, doing something wrong, right? Allah said that those who do a wrong deed followed up with a good deed, and that good deed will expiate for that bad deed. The same thing with regards to the rana on the heart. Right? Those who do a bad deed, but yet they follow up with a good deed, Allah removes that rana. Allah removes that black dot on the heart. Okay? So we followed up with a good deed, whether it's doing some sadaqah, whether it's shaking somebody's hand, right? Whether it's making wudu, right? Doing something good, doing something righteous, doing something that's solid, inshallah. But again, the Prophet Muhammad said that those who continue to do bad deeds, but yet they don't follow it up with a good deed, right? He continues, or she continues to have black dots on the heart, right? To the point that it becomes khatam. Once the whole heart is covered with black dots, therefore, there becomes the seal, the khatam. Those who don't believe in the Quran, those who don't believe in the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad, they will continue to do bad deeds because they don't believe. Inna ladina kafiru, right? Inna ladina kafiru, sawa'un alayhim, a'andartahum, amnam tundirhum, la yu'minun. Those who disbelieve, it's the same for you. Whether you warn them or warn them not, they will not believe. خَتَبَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ سَمْعِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ أَبْصَارِهِمْ غِشَاوَةً. Right? On them is a khatam. Because if you don't believe, you don't believe in the ayats, you don't believe in the scripture, right? Then that means you're going to do whatever it is that you want to do. So all the things that Allah says is haram, all the things that Allah SWT says is forbidden or prohibited, that person does not care because they're doing what it is that they want to do. Right? Allah says don't eat pork, but I'm going to do what I want to do. I like eating pork. But it says in the scripture, I don't care. But yet you say you believe in the Bible. You say you believe in the scripture. You say you believe in the Quran. But you're doing what you want to do. You do not believe. It doesn't matter what you show them. It doesn't matter if you warn them. Man, but it says in Leviticus. It says in Deuteronomy. It says in, I don't care. I'm going to do what I want to do. Right? So therefore that person, they'll continue to involve themselves in sin. And the more that they involve themselves in sin, right, they keep continuing to have these black dots, right? But it says no sex before marriage. I don't care. I'm going to do what I'm going to do. We've been living this life. No boyfriend, girlfriend. I don't care. Don't do this. I don't care. Why? Because they don't believe, right? Belief is manifested by actions. Many people say they believe, but they really don't believe. Belief is manifested by actions. Again, going back to the scripture of old. Wide is the road to destruction. We're using their words, right? But all of this coincides with Quran and Hadith, right? Ibn Abbas, he said, we have the Quran, so there's no need to use the scriptures of old, right? But if we find something in the scripture of old and it coincides with Quran or the Hadith, we say, Alhamdulillah, this is from the remnants of the haq that is still here. But if it be something in the scriptures of old and it contradicts with the Quran and the Surah says, may we take that and throw it out, right? Because the Quran is the haq. Okay? But it said that wide is the road to destruction, narrow is the path to salvation. Same thing with going through the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, be in here like a stranger. There will be a small group that will always be successful, fighting in the cause of Allah. They will never be defeated. They said a small group, right? Coincided with, why is the road to destruction? Narrow is the path to salvation. Narrow is a path that only few can tread. Okay? So he said, why is the road to destruction? Narrow is the path to salvation. So many people claim that they believe, but they don't believe. And again, we're talking about the heart, we're talking about the rana, we're talking about the khatam. Those who don't believe, whether they're Muslim or non-Muslim. You say that you're a Muslim, but yet you don't believe. You say that you believe with your mouth, but you don't believe with your actions. So therefore you continuously involve yourself in sin, whatever that sin may be, whether it's small, whether it's big, right? But after a while, those small sins become big sins. Because you've been doing small sins all your life for many years, it accumulates. You get a dot here, you get a dot there, you get a dot here, you get a dot there, right? You don't follow up that bad deed with a good deed. Those dots are still there, right? And eventually you get the khatam. Eventually you get the seal on your heart. Or you get blockage, right? Just like people that go to the doctor, man, I got blockage in my heart. My arteries is clogged up. The blood ain't flowing properly, so therefore I got a heart disease. I got a problem with my heart. I got a sickness. I can't breathe right. I can't do all of that. Why? I got blockage. The same thing with regards to our eyesight or our ears, the khatam. We got blockage. Man, you got blockage, so you can't even see right. We're not talking about the seeing of the physical seeing, but we're talking about the spiritual eyesight. We're talking about the hearing with a, you know what I'm saying, the spiritual hearing. You got blockage. You're not hearing me. You can't see me. You can't hear me. Right? You can't feel me because there's blockage. Okay? So we got to be careful of that rana. Again, talking about the heart. We got to work on the heart. It doesn't matter what we say. Right? It doesn't matter what we profess. But it's about our actions. Right? If the heart is good, if the heart is pure, right? Then the whole body will be good. Right? Like it says in the scriptures of old, again, coinciding. He said, every good tree bears good fruit. Every good tree, it bears good fruit. You got a good heart, it'll be manifested by your good actions. Right? Every bad tree has bad fruit. You got a bad heart, it'll be manifested by your actions. It'll be manifested by your tongue. You do not have iman unless you rectify your heart, unless you rectify your lisan, unless you rectify your tongue, right? How are you talking? How are you walking? How are you presenting yourself? A person can sit back and tell whether you really have a good heart or not. Let me listen to them. Let me watch them. Let me see how they do. Because if you're really a good person, you really got a good heart, it'll be manifested by your actions, okay? So again, we ask Allah to protect us from that rana. Right? Have taqwa. Right? A taqwa huna. You got a good heart. You got a God-fearing heart. Right? Your heart is conscious of disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if you do something wrong, man, you'll follow up with a good deed. You do something bad, you'll follow up with a good deed. Why? Because you feel it in your heart. You got a good heart. Right? You want to keep your heart pure. Man, I know I did something wrong. You know what? I'm going to go ahead and give some sadaqah. Man, you know what? I'm going to go ahead and do a good deed. Man, I'm going to go ahead and, man, I'm going to give somebody a ride. I'm going to do something, man, because I want to make up for that. A person that don't have a good heart, right, their heart is cold, right? When they talk about a person that's evil, what do they say about his heart? Man, he got a cold heart. Man, he got a black heart, right? Man, his heart is cold. But when they say that a person is compassionate or a person, he's a kind-hearted person, they say he has a warm heart. Oh man, you warm my heart up. It's warm. It's alive. Right? But when your heart is cold, it's blocked out, it's cold. Right? You don't have no feelings. Right? Certain people, they don't have no feelings.